Right, good morning everybody. Today we're going to... Oh, wait, did I press the button on that? I'm pretty sure I did. That's OCD kicking me.
Every time you say that, I
want to
go good morning,
Ben. You can do. You can call me Mr. Martin. Good morning, Mr. Martin. Right, so today we're going to be talking about my favourite, most horrible subject, and it's called Democide. Now, you may have not heard this term before, but it's a rather broad brush to describe what is effectively death by government. Your government or murdering you or somebody else. So first of all, we're going to be looking into details of how we define it, and then we're going to actually look into the philosophical underpinnings of why governments do this and the practical reasoning why governments undertake these sorts of actions against civilians. And then lastly, we're actually going to look at a number of one of the main ways that we can actually mitigate this from happening, but also we're going to look at the particular data sets that we can use to try and predict where there is going to be a risk of democide happening within a nation. And it turns out there are a number of ways you can predict it, because democide tends to happen in a predictable number of states. Okay, so to just give a little bit of context, here are all of the most deadliest events in all of human history. So the orange bar here, that is the real lives lost. And then the grey bar is the lives lost adjusted for the modern day population. So right at the very top there, you've got Genghis Khan. And he killed, if we adjust it for modern day population, he killed somewhere in the region, would have killed somewhere in the region of 800 million people. And that's, and the estimates, well, these are estimates, but the estimates for what the Mongol hordes killed during the time that they were active was somewhere between 12 to 24% of the population. So effectively up to 1 in 4 people alive on the planet at that time were murdered by the Mongol hordes. And then next one down, we've got the Middle East slave trade. This went on for a very long period of time, so that may distort the actual lives lost there. But the Middle East slave trade, unlike the Atlantic slave trade down here, had a slightly different flavour to it. So they wouldn't just take what we call chattel slaves, where you're effectively somebody's property and you just do work for them. But they also indoctrinated these people into their army. So very famously, the Ottoman Empire used to take young Christian boys from the Balkans and from Slavic areas, because of course the word slave is etymology comes from the word Slav. There you go, now you know. And they would indoctrinate them into a group called the Janissaries, and the Janissaries were effectively religious warriors for the Ottoman Empire. The Xin Dynasty, so this is way, way back, this is the first dynasty in China, and to unite... Well, there was a big war of unification, and after that, I forget the name of the emperor, but he was, if you look back in the history books, he's seen as a real nasty character. And he wanted to standardize everything in the Chinese civilization, and killed millions of people. Well, adjusted for today, hundreds of millions of people. Timur, he is also similar to Genghis Khan. He was one of the people that led on to form the Mughal Empire in India. And we've got the Wuxian Revolts, that's China again. Fall of Rome, Atlantic slave trade, conquest of the Americas. Remember, of course, the number of lives lost in that wasn't necessarily through military action by European conquerors. It was mostly by either disease or through slavery enforced on the local population. Second World War, obviously, that's actually the largest loss of life in all of human history, is the Second World War. And that's including the Holocaust and everything in it. And then we go on and on and on. But the interesting thing when you look at this list is that you would expect war to be a more common occurrence for the number of lives lost throughout human history. And yet, war is surprisingly uncommon. Of course, there are terrible wars which have happened. But most of these tend to be uprisings or governments crushing various groups or persecuting various people, or in this case, in the fall of Rome, it's actually a collapse of the governmental institutions and the governmental infrastructure across a continent, which led to, well, a potentially millions of lives lost if we adjusted it for today. And of course, the slave trade, historically, one of the greatest causes of human death, or human murder, throughout history. And this is, effectively what I'm saying, this is this idea of death by government. So I'm going to talk about perhaps the most famous case of democide in human history. So this is what, whenever we can, if you want to picture what democide is, we just consider the Holocaust. And when I was researching for this lecture, trying to find an appropriate image to introduce the Holocaust, I mean, you go through all kinds of horrific stuff, like, you know, in the final days when, you know, the Third Reich is collapsing and they've told all of the guards to kill, they've told all the guards at the concentration camps to kill everybody in the concentration camps, and they put flamethrowers on these people, and there are pictures of, like, of the charred remains of people crawling outside of buildings and caught up in the barbed wire as they're trying to escape the guards killing them. But I think this is perhaps much more representative of the true scale of what happened. So this is from Auschwitz. I think it's fairly obvious what this is. These are just wedding rings. Wedding rings of owned by, I assume, mostly Jews in this case. And assumingly, all of those people were probably murdered by the German government. Well, sorry, the Nazi government, because there is a significant difference there. Now, I just wanted to put this into it. So around about 6 million Jews were killed. But of course, this was not the only people that the Nazis hated. So they killed approximately 220,000 homosexuals, 250,000 Romani gypsies. But the main focus of their hatred, who actually never ended up in camps, but were Slavic populations under occupied lands. I think a vast wave of Russia was effectively depopulated by the panzer divisions encircling entire cities and towns and just murdering everybody within. I mean, we could go into that entire as another lecture, but we'll skip that for now. Now, in the aftermath of this, it was very clear that, well, three things. So first of all, this was intentional. This didn't come about by accident. This was government policy to kill these people. Which is, well, it does happen. And we're going to see it happens quite often, that it is a solution to a problem that the government is facing, and they think that the easiest way to solve this problem is by murdering a bunch of people. And then also you have government institutions backing up this. You have bureaucratic institutions, administrational structure, and national infrastructure, such as the transportation system, set up to support this action. And then finally, there was an ideology behind it. It wasn't just enough that the Nazis had to kill the Jews, but when you listen to a lot of the discussions around it about purifying them and about how evil and how malignant force Jewish people were in German culture, you get to hear something like this, and this is taken from the book The Life and Death of Hitler by Robert Payne, and this is him talking about what to do. Hitler told Himmler that it was not enough for the Jews simply to die, they must die in agony. What was the best way to prolong their agony? Himmler turned his problems over to his advisors, who concluded that slow, agonizing death could be brought about by placing Jewish prisoners in freight cars in which the floors quoted in quicklime, which produced excruciating burns. The advisors estimated it would take approximately 4 days for the prisoners to die, and for the whole time, the freight cars could be left standing in some forgotten siding. Finally, it was decided that freight cars should be used in addition to the extermination camps. So, very famously, towards the end of the war, once it's released to the public, what's gone on? Winston Churchill very famously says, "We're in the presence of a crime without a name." And it didn't take long for somebody to come up with a name. So there's this gentleman here, Raphael Lemkin. He was a Polish lawyer. And he had originally, when the League of Nations was about, he attempted to already define this thing. And he called it acts of barbarity, that were actions undertaken by a state to kill people. And he tried to promote this, and the first case of governments naming something an act of barbarity was under the Ottoman Empire in the First World War and what they did to the Armenians. Now, I'll touch on them in a second, but ultimately this idea didn't carry across. So after the Second World War, he actually re-proposed this idea and he called it genocide. So genos, as in, that's a Greek for clan or family, and side meaning murders. That's effectively genocide, democide, fratricide, matricide. That's what they effectively all mean. And this is his description of what genocide is. So it's whoever, while participating in a conspiracy to destroy a national, racial, or religious group, undertakes an attack against life, liberty, or property of the members of such group, is guilty of the crime of genocide. And now, importantly, the people nowadays, when you are convicted for genocide, you are convicted as an individual. So the individuals who control the policy, who undertake the killings, those are the ones who will be prosecuted under the crime of genocide. However, a nation as a whole is also indicted for genocide as well. So, well, there's probably not a nation out there that is not guilty of genocide at some point in time in history, but now we've got this label that we can stack on it, people can live with the ignoble claim that it is. Right. And once you've got that, I will move on. Okay. Right. So, after the Second World War, and there's a whole bunch of stuff happens after the Second World War, but one of the most important ones is under the leadership of Truman, we get the formation of the UN. And in fact, we get the formation of a whole bunch of international bodies, like the World Trade Organization, the World Bank. And nowadays, we look at all of these bodies with like some kind of horror. It's like, oh, the World Trade Organization is this terrible, evil thing that tries to oppress people. It's not. The point of these organizations is to bring the world under a set of rules. It's so that not only is your nation ruled by the rule of law, but the world is also ruled by the rule of law. And the UN was effectively a body designed so people could come together and they could arbitrate disputes. And under the UN, we have a number of subunits. So there's UNICEF, which is sort of the charitable arm of the UN. But you've also got UNESCO, and UNESCO is the UN Educational, Social, and Scientific and Cultural Organization. And the idea of UNESCO is that it wants to go out into the world, promote scientific cooperation between nations. So they were actually one of the people behind this CERN, Big Particle Accelerator in CERN. But they also try and promote education for everybody in the world. So if you go onto the UNESCO website currently, I think there's a big push for making sure, you know, that every nation gives the women in their nation decent access to education. So as we've seen before, if you educate your women, the country gets rich, because it drags everybody up. And so anyway, UNESCO is formed, I think it's like 1948 it's formed, and they get this big conference together, all the biggest anthropologists and biologists and sociologists in the world, to come together in the aftermath of the Second World War and what they've seen happen, to try and discuss this idea of race. And you know, if there's any backing to it. And this is what they had to say after a particularly long process. So it said, racism is a particularly vicious and mean expression of the caste spirit. It involves belief in the innate and absolute superiority of an arbitrarily defined human group over another equally arbitrarily defined human group. Instead of being based on scientific facts, it is generally maintained in defiance of the scientific methods. To most people, A race is any group of people whom they choose to describe as a race. And the reason they say this is because when you look at the biology, humans haven't been around long enough to diversify into different species. The way you can describe the different groups in the world is like you're more likely to have one set of genes than another. So it doesn't mean, so there's an effect, if you look at a group of people, there is more diversity within that group of people than the differences between these groups. Does that make sense? Yeah. And they also gave rise to the idea of ethnicity. So that's why we describe ethnic groups rather than racial groups nowadays, because race, on a whole, it doesn't really exist. Ethnic groups, however, do. When we talk about ethnicity, we are now taking into account the cultural aspect of a group. So you can be a member of a nation, but and then belong to a specific ethnic group, or you may be born somewhere, but you identify with another ethnic group because that's what your brain culturally you were raised under. So you don't necessarily have to be the race that you would assume that an ethnic group belongs to. And that's why we use the term ethnicity, because, of course, human identity and belonging to a certain group is much more complicated than just the makeup of your DNA. And it is, effectively, this is the underpinning of what we understand of race today, and a lot of our political discussions in the world of race today is built around this idea put forward by UNESCO in 1950. And because of this, because everybody on the planet is effectively the same race, therefore it makes sense that we should ultimately have the same rights and come up and fall under the same rule of law as any other human on the planet. Because underneath everything, we are broadly the same individuals. Okay, so now we've got this understanding of like the fundamental parts of what happened after the Second World War, why we talk about race and ethnicity in the way we do. We're now going to move on to this idea called democide. So this was put forward by a gentleman called R.J. Rummel in 1944. There's a wonderful book out there, if you can get your hands on it, called A Death by Government, where he describes these things called the mortocracies. These are governments throughout history which have murdered populations. And he describes democide under the three following terms. It says, first of all, we've got genocide. So it says, among other things, the killing of a people by government because of their indelible group membership, so i.e. race, ethnicity, religion, language. Politicide, so that's the murder of any persons or people by a government because of their politics or for a political purpose. Or mass murder, so that's the indiscriminate killing of any person or people by a government. And then finally we define democide as the murder of any person or people by government, including genocide, politicide, and mass murder. So to give you an idea of what all of these three are, so genocide, I think probably the most, just think back to what the Nazis did against the various groups they didn't like. Politicide, so that's often, this was often committed by the communist regimes during the 20th century. Very famously, Mao, they labelled anybody who was a landowner as a seditionist, and you were encouraged to kill landowners. And this could have meant somebody who owned acres and acres of land and had lots of renting tenants on there, or that could have just been a farmer who simply had a field passed down to them by their family over generations and generations. It did not matter into the eyes of the communists. All the communists saw was a bourgeois. That was all they saw, and therefore that person must die because they were a landowner, because they were oppressing the proletariat. And finally, mass murder. Mass murder is kind of like the nuclear option for governments. It's usually undertaken when they face a crisis, and it's the easiest option. So think of Tiananmen Square. You got a whole bunch of students going spare in Tiananmen Square, refusing to step down. And the Chinese government see this problem coming to a head. If those protests spread across the country, it could go like wildfire. So they decide the quickest and easiest option is to just force those people out. And if people die in the process, then so be it. Anyways. Right, so we've got all of that. Okay, cool. Okay, so let's have a look at the ways that governments tend to commit genocide. So, up top, prisons and camps. So death and murder as a result of incarceration in prisons or concentration camps. So we tend to think concentration camps were invented in the Second World War. And to be fair, they've been around for much of human history. I think the first case of it was something what we'd recognise as a concentration camp actually happened in the American Civil War, where they would incarcerate Northern Unionist troops in Confederate camps. But the first term of concentration camp when it appears in history was against the Boer people in the Boer War. So the British Empire goes over there after the Boers are getting up to sea, and they want their own independence, their own free nation. We decide that's unacceptable, and we put huge portions of the Boer population into these concentration camps where they start dying in huge numbers. The concentration camps were eventually taken down after, I forget her name, but she was just effectively just some random housewife. And she was very concerned about this and actually took a trip to South Africa and saw these concentration camps. I believe she took photos because photography was just coming around at that time. And she came back and she petitioned the UK Parliament and showed people and effectively published what she saw in newspapers, and the British Empire was effectively shamed by the population and the media into closing down the concentration camps. Forced labour, so that's pretty much self-explanatory. These two here were like the main tools of Soviet Russia. Forced labour and prison camps as well are used extensively under North Korea currently at the moment, which we're going to see later. Terror, so terror is when you're targeting specific groups. So again, think of sort of the Night of the Long Knives under Nazi Germany, or again, it's like Stalinist purges when you're looking for seditious elements of your population. Massacres, so indiscriminate mass murder again. Famine and disease. There's a whole number of times where governments have deliberately imposed famine on people or introduced disease in it. So during the large collectivization in Soviet Russia, or in the Soviet Empire, in Ukraine, they forced a lot of the farmers off their land, because of course they were landowners, and there was a nationalist uprising against this, so Stalin said, well, fuck you, you're not having any of your food, and thus millions of people died. If you think about disease, think about the colonial governors in the New World who are introducing blankets laced with TB, because of course Europeans are mostly immune to TB, not completely, but mostly immune to it. But of course the local populations weren't, they died. You know, this was a common way to get rid of various tribes. You say, here, have all these supplies. Next thing you know, it's got 100% mortality rate in this population, and you can just move right in. Deportation. So, I forgot to really talk about it, but the Armenian Genocide. So, during the Second World War, the Ottoman Empire came to distrust the Armenian population within it. So it's very much the same case as the Nazi government distrusting the Jews in the Second World War. They viewed the Armenians as like a seditious fifth column element within their society. So the government expelled them from Turkey into the deserts of Syria, where they died in their millions. Well, hundreds of thousands, really, many, many, many people. Turkey still refuses to admit that this happened. They're saying, "Well, we didn't kill people. It's not a genocide or a democide." But if through their actions, they brought about the death of these people, and this was like a big sticking point for a long time. Turkey would be accepted into the EU if it accepted that the Ottoman Empire had committed these crimes. It hasn't yet. Genocide, I think we've covered extensively. Prisoners of war, so just think of, again, the Second World War, the treatment that Soviets and the Nazis did to each other's prisoners. I mean, it was absolutely unreal. If you were a German or an Allied prisoner, and you're caught in either one of their camps, they would probably treat you pretty good. But if you're a Soviet, or if you're a Nazi, and you're in the other one's camps, they would just leave you to starve to death, or work you to death. And then finally, bombing. So the Allies were particularly egregiously guilty of this one, with like vast bombing campaigns. So Bomber Harris, he eventually received a knighting for what he did during the Second World War, and it did bring Germany to its knees. However, we have very famous cases like the giant firestorm of Dresden, when the bombing was so intense, it effectively caused a hurricane of fire throughout the city that just killed people by their thousands. And of course, let us not forget the bombings of Nagasaki and Hiroshima. Now, when Oppenheimer completed the construction of the nuclear bomb, so he was the leader of the Manhattan Project, he completed the construction of the nuclear bomb, they tested out in Trinity, New Mexico, and they go, holy shit, what have we made? And very famously, he quotes from a Hindu text where he says, I have become Shiva, destroyer of worlds, because he's realized what he's made. And they actually sent a letter to the American government saying, don't drop this bomb. Don't drop this bomb on civilians. Drop it somewhere outside just to show them what we can do. But effectively, Truman saw it as a really efficient form of bombing. Instead of sending hundreds of planes over enemy territory to bomb them and risk your own pilots, he just thought, well, we're only just going to risk one plane this time. And that's effectively how they saw it. They saw it as an efficient way of doing it. Plus, it put the shits out the Soviets, and therefore made them realise what they were able to deal with. Okay. So let's have a look at a quick few democides throughout history. So, ironically, on the left, we have the right-wing governments. On the right, we have the left-wing governments. So, Nazi Germany, we've already covered. I think that picture spells out quite clearly like what's driving the force of the Nazi government here. It's this idea of a better future. It's this ideology of a better future. And down here, we've got Imperial Japan. So this is like during the war period. So it invades China in 1936. But it's actually had it's not a really bloody coup, but it has a coup in 1911 when the military effectively take over. And you can see the Japanese flag here now has these rays coming out from the central sun. Nowadays, the Japanese flag is red dot, but they got rid of these rays of sun because they obviously represent the expansionist nature of this empire. And, I mean, they've done terrible things like the rape of Nanking. You can find it online if you really want to, but there's an image of a baby in Nanking gets thrown in the air, and there's a Japanese soldier bare netting this child as it's falling from the air. And then you have like the terrible crimes of Unit 731, who were never really held to account. So Unit 731 were the only really biological weapons division that actually made and used biological weapons throughout history, and they used to do awful, awful, awful things. If you really want to know what they did, look up a film called The Men Behind the Sun. It's absolutely horrible. It's like a film about Unit 731. But effectively, what they used to do is tie up a lot of the Chinese prisoners in the fields, and they would infect them with plague or whatever. And then they would harvest them. And eventually, in the final days of Nanking, they had bombers fly over the city, and they bombed the city with crates of fleas infested with plague. So it's one of the only real cases of biological warfare used in history. And it was devastating. And as I said, after the Second World War, because the Americans wanted this information, they gave, like a lot of like the Nazi scientists, they gave them like a free handout. But whereas, you know, the Nazi scientists gave us the space race, these guys didn't really provide that much of use throughout history. So against Soviet Russia, this is a poor gentleman here in his last few moments. I'm sure you can't see the image very well, but he's giving the camera a fuck you stare there. But he is just one of the many, many victims of the Soviet purges throughout the Soviet territories during this period. And we'll look at that in a bit more detail, but they were extensive but horrible. Fatty McFuckface, logging onto his AOL account there. If there's anybody in history who deserves the diabetes and gout that they have, it's surely him. North Korea, we're going to look in great detail in a bit, but they're still committing terrible crimes against their own population. It is lucky that they have effectively been muted from exercising their violence outside of their borders, but yeah, they're still causing horrible suffering inside the borders. Now, the Khmer Rouge hold the rather unpleasant distinction of having the most complete democide in history. So they killed approximately 30% of their population. And what makes the Khmer Rouge particularly unpleasant is this: their ideology that they had is this thing called peasantism. They believed, as I'll describe later, it was developed by other philosophers earlier on in history, that they wanted to make a utopian socialist bronze, like Iron Age utopia. They were of the belief that technology and urbanization and intellectualism was bad. It removes us inherently from what it means to be human. So the Khmer Rouge very famously emptied entire cities of people. And if you were in any way considered an intellectual, so if you're wearing glasses, if they saw you wearing glasses, you were a dead man. They saw you as part of this intelligentsia, and that, again, Pol Pot was never really held to account. Now, you may not see this very well on this image here, but this tree here is covered in lots of like little bands. These are sort of bracelets. And the Khmer Rouge, being mostly peasant farmers, whatever they were, young children, who didn't have gigantic resources, they didn't have all the bullets to kill all the prisoners they wanted. So in this case, they would execute young children and toddlers by grabbing them by the ankles and swinging their heads against this tree until they were dead. So they were truly some of history's most unpleasant people. And then finally we got down in here in communist China. So in communist China, a lot of the deaths were through deliberate purges, but a lot of the deaths were through mismanagement and incompetence. So one of the worst policies set forward by the Communist Party was this idea that they were going to do what Mao called the Great Leap Forward. China was going to undo a good century of humiliation by the Western nations of completely overtaking them and defeating them under the numerous opium wars. And so they were going to industrialize the countryside. And the way they were going to do this was to build all these smelting units in villages and small towns. And then they were to throw in all of their tools, and they're going to smelt down all of these tools to make iron, which they can convert into something new. But does anybody here know how to smelt down iron? I don't know how to smelt iron. I don't know how to make steel. But these people, who were just a few weeks before that, were just farmers, were expected to smelt iron. And of course they didn't. They just created slag, which was absolutely useless, and it went to waste. And of course, because you don't have the tools, you can't cook your food, you can't till your fields properly enough. So they starved. And there's very famous cases of Mao going to towns in the middle of the countryside. And they would ship in, you know, millions of rice plants, and they would plant them in the field when he had gone to visit. And they would have giant flat fans blowing on these rice plants. They wouldn't rot. And he would turn up, and everybody would wave and smile. And when he'd gone, all the rice plants had rotted into nothingness. So there's some of the most notable ones in history. It's worth taking into account that, I'll come to that in a bit. Okay, so this is again from Death by Government by Mr. R.J. Rummel. So what we're looking at here is the biggest killers throughout the 20th century. I'll only look at them briefly, but biggest killer in 20th century, these are all in millions, by the way. So we've got what we call our deca mega murderers. So that's people who have killed, institutions which have killed tens of millions of people. So we've got People's Republic of China, they're at number one with 76 million. It's actually much more than that. These numbers have been adjusted once China has opened up and we've seen more about the death tolls. It's actually closer to over 100 million. The USSR, 61 million. Colonialism, just in general, between all the colonial governments, 50 million. So think about British suppression of Mau Maus in Kenya, Germany. I also think that colonialism takes back before the 20th century as well. Germany, so that's obviously Nazi regime, 20 million. China, so that's the nationalist government of China that existed before the Second World War, We now know them today as Taiwan, or they're effectively the current version of the nationalist government in China. So mega murderers, these are people which killed a million or more. So that's Imperial Japan, 6 million, China and Bao Soviets. I think that's during like the Civilist War, during the final days of the Second World War. Cambodia, which is Khmer Rouge. Turkey's, during the Ottoman Empire before the end of the First World War. Vietnam, of course, under Ho Chi Minh. Poland, will be under communist rule. Pakistan, Bangladesh, after there's the partition of India into Pakistan and India, Bangladesh decides to declare independence from Pakistan as its own entity. So the Pakistani government cracks down on them, and it's a really, really, really unpleasant war that goes on there. Yugoslavia, done by Tito, and of course, when he finally died, I think deservedly did, Yugoslavia fell apart into its various constituent groups. We have the Yugoslavian, it's not really a civil war, but there's a hyper-nationalism by the Serbian government. And there's some really, if you want to watch a really horrible documentary, there's one, Cry from the Grave, and it's about the town during, you know, the collapse of, but there's a UN force in the town surrounded by Serbian forces, and they broker a deal saying the Serbian forces are going to bust them out, and the UN will leave and it will allow them to take the land. And unfortunately, what the Serbians didn't tell them was that they were going to bust these people out and shoot them. And they died in their thousands. And then mega murderers, these are people. These are potential mega murderers that we can't really prove. So you've got North Korea, Mexico, that's during like the Civil War era, and Russia during like the Tsarist era, and Cento Kilo mega murderers, which is basically nations which have killed 100,000 or more, but various Chinese warlords, because China has such a denser population. If you kill people there, it usually produces a much higher death toll. Turkey under Ataturk, that's after the Turkish War for Independence and the formation of the modern Turkish nation. The UK, so that's us. I think a lot of that's probably going to be down to the bombing campaigns during the Second World War. But of course, you've also got deaths there from colonialism. Portugal and then Indonesia under there. So there you go. Quick rundown on some of the worst killers of the 20th century. Yes?
Do you have any idea why they don't know about the...
Of these ones?
Yeah.
Because, well, with North Korea, we can assume they've been killing a whole bunch of people, but the reason that we know the USSR killed all these people and the People's Republic of China killed all those people is because the records are available. We don't know that the records are available. We don't know what the records are in North Korea, because of course they won't tell us. And for example, under Russia, when the communists took over, they burnt a whole bunch of the archives. So we don't know the actual actions that were undertaken. And also during this period, so this also includes like the Russian Revolution, it's just so chaotic. There's very little record keeping from that time. Under Mexico, I'm not too familiar with the Mexican Civil War, but basically there was a succession of dictators in Mexico. So they all probably did each other's best to burn previous administrations' like information. That's my guess. But it's usually from lack of record keeping.
What was the definition for
Deca mega murderers are, it's tens of millions. Okay. Mega murderers is millions. And cento kilo mega murderers is hundreds of thousands. I mean, it's still staggering numbers of people. Right. Okay, so we'll quickly look at what happened in Soviet Russia during this period. So this is, we're going a long time here, and these are deaths. The hatched ones are civilians, and the dashed line is like the total dead. So if we actually look at the Second World War, this is the total number of dead civilians in Russia during that period, and that's actually the total dead. That little extra on top is actually soldiers. The rest of it is civilians, and that was murdered by both the Soviet government through purges and the Nazi troops going into there. But you see, even after the Second World War, there's still huge amounts of people dying, and, you know, under systematic oppression by the government. But of course, the biggest jump here in deaths comes with like this initial collectivization, this initial. So what I was talking about earlier. So if you're a farmer, you're a landowner, they'll kick you off your land, and they put a commune in there instead, who have no fucking clue how to farm land because they were, you know, they lived in urban populations, but this was this utopian ideal by the Soviet government, is that through will and hard work and good design, you could solve all these problems. But of course, it turns out you need experience and understanding to do specific jobs. And this line here, this is the total population of Russia dying per that year. So at its very peak, its dying population is close to 1.3% of the population is dying every year through various actions by the government. So that's over 1 in 100 people is getting murdered by the government every year, which is insane, absolutely insane. And then if we look over here, so this is like when we take into account all the aggregate deaths there. So the black line there, that's the amount of war deaths that that's including the Second World War there. It just nips off, of course, they surrendered during the First World War, so that doesn't include First World War deaths, but that's Second World War deaths. But these are the deaths committed by the government on its own civilians. So, and the vast number of deaths there were under the Gulag system. So if you were seditionist, you would be sent off to the Gulags in Siberia, where, well, you would be worked to death, or you would just be left to rot and die under those awful conditions. Okay, so let's look into the actual motives of why these governments do this. So, first of all, we've got one of the motives is destruction of a group perceived to be a threat to the regime. So, this is actually people who are seen as potentially, you know, they can form nationalist movements against you, they could group together and overthrow your government. So, for example, as I've already described, the crackdown in East Pakistan, which is now Bangladesh, the Rwandan genocide, so of course the Hutsis hated the Tutsis because there was a great tribal inter-rivalry between the two groups, so the Hutsis turned on the Tutsis, and then the Tutsis turned on the Hutsis, and Rwanda has won the medal for the quickest democide in history, for the most amount of people being killed in the shortest amount of time. And then finally again, seizure of foodstuffs in Ukraine during Soviet Russia. Destruction of a group of people hated, envied or despised. I think we don't have to go any further than looking at Nazi Germany or the Armenian genocide under the Ottoman Empire. Ideological purity. So this was, as I've described before, this was particularly common under communist governments, with this idea that if you don't fit the mould, if you have wrong thoughts, then you should be out on your arse, or preferably dead. Purification. So you often hear this idea when people are talking about democide, these governments, they're talking about, you know, cleaning up the nation. I think Slobodan Milosevic, he was very famously to say he was going to clear out the weeds from the country. And then finally, and perhaps most distastefully, because at least here people are deluded into these ideas that they need to make the world a better place, sometimes it's just plain greed. And colonialism is perhaps the best example of that. I think, or institutional slavery, of course. I think the best example of that would be King Leopold and his treatment of people in the Congo. Congo, incredibly rich in mineral resources. When the local population started to rise in unrest against the Belgian colonial overlords, King Leopold basically implemented the rule that he would cut people's hands off and tell them to work harder. And then was extremely upset to find that when you cut people's hands off, that the productivity under your colony suddenly dramatically drops. So he punished people more, and thus it spiraled out of control. Right. Mm-hmm. Okay, we all good? You all good, Sam? Yep, cool. Okay, so perhaps it's worth talking about. So I don't know how well you guys know your philosophy. I love my philosophy, so I'm just going to briefly go over how these ideas came about. So way, way, way back, classical period, there's this motto of, right, the strong do what they must and the weak must endure, which effectively says, if you're a strong empire, you've got to subjugate, well, you can do whatever you want. And if you're not a very strong empire, you make friends with the strong empires and you wait for them to start collapsing and then you stab them in the back. But effectively, in the classical period, you didn't really, there was no idea of human rights or war crimes. It just simply was the way of the world. Like, there was an unwritten rule that if a besieging army arrives at a city and they go into the city and go surrender, if the city surrenders and lets people come in and loot it, then most of the population is left untouched. But the moment the first siege engine is fired or touches the walls, all bets are off. But anyway, after a long period in the Middle Ages, and we eventually get what we now call the Enlightenment, the Renaissance. And it's during this time that numbers of important, powerful families in Italy start discovering ancient Greek texts from the Islamic world. So traditionally in Europe at that time, people were following Aristotle. And Aristotle, he's known as the curmudgeon. If you read his texts, they're quite practical. He has very little to say on politics. But Plato did. And Plato had this very famous book called Plato's Republic. It's a very interesting book about like what he thinks is a perfect society. And it turns out, if you read it now, it's like a totalitarian caste system, but it got into the people's ideas in the Renaissance of this idea that, yes, you could make a perfect government. So look, we get loads of philosophers coming along trying to talk about how to create good governments to make it better for the people. So we've got Hobbes is the guy who comes up with the idea of a social contract that the leaders will provide for the population, and in turn, the population will give that leader legitimacy. And he was the guy that described life before civilization was nasty, brutish, and short. Rousseau, a French philosopher, who said that inherently technology and property is inherently bad for the human spirit and removes us from it. He is a forerunner of what eventually becomes primitivism and peasantivism, and effectively leads the way for all the romantic movement, which we'll talk about in a sec. But he was the guy, he said before civilization, unlike Hobbes, humanity, we were noble savages. You know, we didn't draw a line in the ground and say this is mine. We were better people. And then Locke is somewhere in between. And then there's this great divide between the British empiricists and the European romanticists. British empiricists effectively say, if you make a claim, you go prove it. Where's the data? Prove it. And we've got people like John Stuart Mill's, who try and make happiness for the sake of happiness. Whereas the European romantics tend to have this idea that life has there's a secret source to happiness. That if you only just knew the reality of things, we could make the world a better place. And that, from Rousseau, is where we get the ideas of fascism and communism, the left and the right, is these ideas. the problem is, though, and I think we look at both of them, we very well know that fascist governments are despicable, but we tend to give a lot of socialist governments a free ride because we think, oh, socialism is quite nice and airy-fairy. But we've already looked in history, they've been, for the 20th century, they've been the biggest killers. So be wary of ideologues, be wary of people espousing a certain ideology. I mean, by all means, argue with them, but don't necessarily believe what they have to say. And of course, both roots of philosophy comes up with their own problems. Capitalism, of course, has its own limitations if you leave it completely to run by its own. But of course, as I said, socialism and romanticism and fascism have their own real problems at the moment. And that's a quick idea of like where these ideas come from. It's this idea that we can build a better world and the enlightenment gave us wonderful tools to try and build better governments. But some times people take these ideas to an extreme and they view the idea as more important than the individuals. Okay, so now we're going to move on to the risk factors for democide. So we've got an underpinning of how we understand how democide, what drives it, but let's, and why people do it. But now we're going to look at ways we can mitigate it and how we're going to measure the risks of it. So first of all, we want to look at the level of political freedom. So this is the ability for your population to express their own political ideas. Concentration of political power. So generally, democides happen when an individual or a certain institution within your government has a huge concentration of power. They can act arbitrarily because there's nobody stopping them. Ideology. So we've already discovered that some ideologies are more disposed to murdering its populations than others. Economics. Sometimes it just makes good economic sense to murder a bunch of your population. And I think that this is what's happened to the Jews many, many times in history. Because they were refused to work, they all became moneylenders. And because they became moneylenders, they had loads of money, so they were killed for their money. War. There's suddenly, if your nation's at war, there is suddenly a massive increase in risk of the nation committing democide. And then finally, and I think most importantly, is this idea of the rule of law. Humans, Britain seems to have been very stable for a long time because we're quite good at following the rule of law. I think a while ago, Gordon Brown was talking about, what makes British, I think it's more than anything else, this idea of the rule of law. It's what's given Britain the stability and allows it to enjoy its big, having a fairly decent economy. Right, so political philosopher by the name of Francis Fukuyama released this book quite recently called it's a two-set volume, it's The Rise of it's Political Order and Political Decay. And he has a theory that all nations in this world, what makes them successful or unsuccessful nations, is these three pillars. And if you don't have these three pillars, your government can act in an arbitrary manner. And if it can act in an arbitrary manner, then it's obviously going to hurt its population. So first, we've got a strong and modern, capable reform state. So remember, state has to have a monopoly on violence. That is to say, it has to be the one carrying the guns, and nobody else in your state can enact violence without the state's explicit authority. But it also means that the state must be able to enact policies freely and with capability. If a state is not able to enact policies, then how on earth is it going to be able to change its situation? So the rule of law, I think, so this is importantly, it means that everybody in your country is under the rule of law. That means even the policymakers, even your president and your ministers. So there are plenty of countries out there in the world, so Saudi Arabia, for example, the rule of law does not exist for a large portion of the ruling class. Accountability, so this is the idea that the government gets legitimacy because it is representing people in the nation. And this is why democracy works so well. And because democracy is able to raise large taxes, because we effectively say, you're representing us, so we're happy to hand over our money. Well, we're not happy to hand over our money, but we hand over our money. And that idea of accountability is behind so much. So in ancient China, there was this thing called the Mandate of Heaven. And you were able to rule with the Mandate of Heaven until people got uppity, raised an army, and fought against you. And they would seize the Mandate of Heaven. It's effectively like this divine judgment that you were ruling because you were able to rule. It was the same with monarchy. If Sam was a king, and I decided I liked his lands, I rolled in with an army, killed Sam, sorry Sam. I took his crown.
Try.
But that's what a good monarch would say. But I will kill you. And I will take your lands. And because of that, I would have divine right to do it. Because that's how monarchy was. It was effectively, it was like, if you seize the crown, that is your legitimacy of ruling the land. And that's another form of accountability there. And so we get this idea of what we call getting to Denmark. So we see Denmark as the ideal state. I don't know why particularly Denmark, but if you ask me, it was like, where's the best state in the world? People tend to say Denmark. And this is like a nice Venn diagram of these different governments overlapping with each other. So in the middle, we've got these three countries here, which have the benefits of a strong, modern, capable state, which is accountable to its population and does have the rule of law. But then we've got some other countries which don't. So for example, modern China and Russia, it's got very capable states. Russia perhaps not so, but China has a very capable state of enacting policy whenever it wants. The problem is that its rulemakers do not appear to be under the rule of law, although there seems to be great changes happening in China at the moment, so it's moving towards this direction as there are big crackdowns of corruption within the government. But even still, the policymakers are not under the rule of law. Then at the bottom here, so let's look at India, for example. It is both accountable to its population because we've got regular elections, and the people there, including the lawmakers, are under the rule of law. Unfortunately, India is having problems. India is very famous for having a poor infrastructure. It looks like Modi is going a long way to undo that. So India is moving up towards this way. So this is this idea that we want to make it to Denmark. You got all of these. We want all of these things balanced in perfection, and that's going to give us a good, strong, capable state, which is going to treat its civilians nicely. Okay, well, I did say we're going to have a break there, but I'm afraid we're just going to roll on through. No, I need to... Do you want to just...
For a moment.
You want to run to the loo? Mm-hmm. Okay, well, Tony, why don't you run to the loo? And there you go. And in the moment, we'll just enjoy some nice bit of My Little Pony Friendship's Magic. If anybody here a brain? I'm not. Or a Pegasus, I believe, is the other term. So if we're going to be looking at how we're going to measure it and how we're going to mitigate it, so I'm going to roll over the mitigation part because it's going to be, I think, measuring it's more important. But so let's have a look. So mitigations, the best ways of mitigating these processes. Generally, we want a political solution to democide. We want to be able to go in and under diplomacy and discuss with our government why there are problems. And then hopefully we can force them, you know, we can pressure them or force them into or shame them into doing something better. Also making sure you've got good legal systems. And this is where, you know, when I'm talking about this post-war world, post-Second World War world, where we've got all these international organisations. This is where the legal system is important. If we can set up a global legal system, then it is much harder for nations to commit various crimes. I remember, since the Hague, the War Crimes Court, was set up, individual leaguers now have a place where they can get prosecuted for various crimes. So now there's actually a legal incentive for a lot of people not to commit these crimes. And then, of course, finally, you've got military interventions. Sometimes they are necessary, only to save a lot of lives. Yugoslavia is an excellent example of that. Many people died, but many more people would have died had we not intervened in that. Now, I know it's gone a little bit skew with in recent years with Twat, otherwise known as the War Against Terror, but rolling into Iraq, and I think that's burnt a lot of people's fingers. When there were some terrible things happening in the world, but because Iraq was seen as such a dreadful failure, nations are not willing to try and step in and save lives. And now we've got all kinds of problems. And then, but perhaps the best way of dealing with this is the nip it in the bud. And we can do that through these various ways of trying to measure the risk. So direct observation at the locale. So we're going to look at election observations. Remote sensing. So we're going to have a look at a great example of remote sensing in a bit, where you can just put a satellite over the top of an authoritarian company in a country and they can't do bugger all about it. And then finally through various composite values. And these values are going to be extremely useful and perhaps the main tool that you guys can use to actually measure this stuff. Right, so before we go on any further, we'll just wait for Sam. So we're going to be getting on to the fun stuff. It's nice to know he's washing his hands, that's why he's taking so long, unless he needs to do a master poo. Any questions so far? No, we're all good? It's all fairly self-explanatory. Yeah. Government's bad because they think they can get away from it. There you go. It's good to know you wash your hands. Right. So I was just quickly saying, so we're going to look at measuring and mitigation. I'll explain all of these in greater detail as we go through. So I'll be done. I'm going to have to rush through this a little bit. But political system, so ideally you want a diplomatic solution to it. Legal system, so you think international frameworks that present obstacles from people committing democide, and finally military interventions, which, you know, they're sometimes necessary. But we're going to be looking in more detail at measuring the risk of democide. So that's through like direct observations at the site, remote sensing, or through these specific values. So the first thing we're going to look at is election monitoring. I'm just going to fly through this, but effectively the idea of election monitoring is that you go in, I think, you go into a country and you try to make sure that their elections follow the right process. And we've got, and if they follow the right process, then that's great. And this, most of what this is describing here, these are the points that that election observation tries to make sure the country is keeping to. So you want the separation of, and balance of power, so everybody's got their own bit. Independence of the judiciary, so that your courts are not beholden to government. Pluralistic system of political parties and organisations, as well as media there as well. And also you've got accountability, rule of law. I think this is important here, this idea of a pluralistic nature of your society. You don't want to suppress other people's voices, even if they're unpleasant motherfuckers, like the BNP or whatever. You've got to give them enough rope to hang themselves. If you start telling people they can't talk, or I know it's happening in universities all across the country, they're trying to shut down various speakers. If that speaker gets shut down, people are going to get angry and they're going to dump down on their ideas. And that's exactly what happened with UKIP and Brexit, is that people who voted for UKIP or had issues, they were told they're racists. And because they were told they're racist, they got angry because they weren't. And they just doubled down and they became more motivated to do what they did. So there's a warning there. Don't shut down people's voices, even though you disagree with them. And then, we've got EU election monitoring mission. So this is the big organisation which does this nowadays. They go out to various countries at the behest of the country invites you. I think sometimes they're basically pressured to do it. But the idea is you go in there, you're completely impartial, you follow all of the laws of that country, and then you're just there to report. You're not there to like go, oh, I don't think you should be doing that. You're just there to stand in the back of a clipboard and go, mm-hmm, or just shake your head silently. And yeah, you can always go and volunteer for these guys. Great on your CV. So they do that before you Brexit. So, but what we're going to look at now is perhaps a better way of looking at what's going on. So this is from a series of photos that were taken by a company called All Source Analysis. They're a fantastic GIS company. They basically take high resolution pictures of various areas and they just analyze it. And this is for like political hotspots in the world. So if you go onto their website, there's like images of like a Chinese buildup in the South China Sea. But anyway, what we're going to be looking at is they did a flyby high res commission of known as Camp 25 in North Korea. This is thought to hold around about 5,000 people, although some of the larger camps have been thought to hold up to around about 80 to 120,000. And some of these large camps are absolutely gigantic. But the reason we chose this camp, or they chose this camp, is because it's smaller and more manageable. Right, let's have a look at what we see. So, you can't see them too well, we've got like these yellow outlines here. These are some of the boundaries of some of these large internment camps in North Korea. I mean, as you can see, some of these are absolutely gigantic. We're talking tens and tens of kilometers square. But what we're looking at is Camp 25, under here. Just near the Chinese border. And here's a close-up of the camp itself. So I'll just quickly go through it. So you've got the barracks for the guards here and lots of like various administrative buildings. Somebody's worked out that this could possibly be like a Kim Il-sung memorial hall. A big golden statue of him. Possible gallows there, well that's nice to know. But interestingly enough, and this is a prison, remember, we've got an industrial area, a lumber yard there. So they have industry in this camp, which is a bit weird. But I think perhaps most interestingly of all is that you can see around here is the terraced hilltops there. And it's the only reason that people can assume why they would have terraced hills in that area is that they're producing rice. And that's a very interesting point about these camps. I'll let you to guess, any guesses now why these camps are so important to North Korea? No? Okay, well, I'll show you a few more pictures and you might. So this is a bit more up close. So there we go. A wood products factory, prisoner housing, just there, but the vast majority of all this seems to be commercial in nature to make produce, greenhouse and agricultural support. This is not what you would expect to find in a prison. So there's an old cemetery there, obviously, where they chuck all the prisoners that they murder. But this here is an anti-aircraft position. And why would you need an anti-aircraft position at a prison? You expect the only thing that's going to happen there is prisoners escaping. Unless, of course, that the prison is so valuable to your country's economy that you cannot risk it getting attacked. And this is the vicious evil cycle of the North Korean justice system, or Gulag system, is that these camps are a vital part of its infrastructure because it's been. Because they're so isolationist, they use these camps to produce the food and the goods for their country. So this means that it's this bizarre vicious cycle, it's that they need a large prison population to support their economy. So to make their economy work well, they need people to buy their stuff, but to buy their stuff they need to imprison a bunch of people. So that's why they need an anti-aircraft position there. Right, just quickly look at these composite values in the last few minutes. So, we're going to look at four composite values here. There's a whole bunch of them that you can use out there. There's one called the Corruption Perception Index that tells you how corrupt, well, it's not how corrupt a country is, how perceived corrupt it is. So, for example, I remember reading ages ago, but for example, a lot of people in Britain assume that Britain's fairly corrupt. In the grand scheme of things, corruption tends to mean an MP buying using their expenses to buy duck houses and stuff like that, which really on the grand scheme of things in terms of corruption is hardly bad. But let's go through this. So we've got the Gini coefficient, that is to measure inequality within a country. And I'm afraid the image I'm using this is out of date now, because I saw a new one on the way down as I was reading the news. The freedom scales, this determines how free your population is to express their political opinion. Index of economic freedom, so that's how free you are to conduct your own economic desires. And finally, the rule of law index, which is quite self-explanatory. So, the Gini coefficients. So the Gini coefficient is this wonderful metric that we use to describe the share of wealth within a nation. So, if a country has a Gini coefficient of zero, that means there is perfect equality in terms of wealth distribution. So everybody has the exact same amount of money. What that would mean in reality is probably that everybody's dirt poor, or everybody's hunter-gatherers, because everybody has to share the wealth. And a measure of 100 is perfect inequality, so that means that there is a single individual owns all of the wealth within the country. So, and there's debate as to where the perfect point of the Gini coefficient is. I think it's, well, usually it's hovering around somewhere between 30 to 40-ish. So, have a quick look on the next image to show us. So this was, I believe this is 2012? I could be wrong. Currently, Russia is the most unequal country in the world. But, so this was a few years ago, so as you can see, like, the wealth disparity since, I suppose, since the embargoes against Russia has happened, wealth inequality has increased dramatically. But as you can see, the countries that you would expect to have a fairly low Gini coefficient, with having a fairly equal spread of wealth, are the countries that you would expect to have a fairly equal spread of wealth. So most of them are fairly developed nations. And the countries that you would expect that don't have an equal spread of wealth are the countries that you don't have expect to have. So, of course, South Africa, still living with the hangover of apartheid. Some of the population owns dramatically vast amounts more than other parts of the nations. And so UK and United Kingdom, of course, we use a much more competitive form of capitalism than many of the other countries which embrace a bit more socialistic form of capitalism. Therefore, you would expect to see a bit more inequality in the UK and the US, but even still, that's what, between 35 and 40. So this is what I'm saying, there's this argument, whereas, because we know both these countries are very rich, but is it perfect? Lots of communist countries, you know, ex-communist countries are still suffering with the hangover of communism to try and make their country more equal. But the interesting outlier on this is South America. Any guesses why South America has a generally very high Gini coefficient? No? It's because their aristocracy avoided getting murdered by all the popular uprisings in Europe. So their aristocracy, their elites, never got kicked out of government. So they do this thing called rent seeking, where they basically own parts of the government and make huge amounts of cash off that. So South America, even though it has excellent political freedom, tends to be very unequal because of this historical thing of the elites never giving up their power. Freedom scale. So this is governed by an NGO called Freedom House. It was formed again after the Second World War. This rates nations in the world according to their level of freedom. So that's free, partially free, or not free. Those are the three things that you can do. And it's every year they produce this big book called the Human Rights Watch Book, which I bought this year. You can literally read through it and read all the human rights transgressions in there. It's a thoroughly entertaining read. So I'll just quickly show you what this looks like. So again, it's pretty much what you would expect. So green is free, yellow is partially free, blue is not free. As you can see, many former communist nations still only partially free. Many of the developed nations, again, South America, very free nations. But of course, you've got vast swathes of Africa still not free. That's because it's Africa still, mark my words, in 30 years, Africa's going to be doing what China is now. It's going to be a economic force in the world, but at the moment it's still getting itself on the feet. The Global Economic Freedom Index, so this is the idea that there's a best way to describe it is ease of running a business. So it's worth noting that the company that, well, the think tank that runs this is the Heritage Foundation, who are known for being a libertarian organisation. So they have their own biases of what counts as economic freedom, but it's effectively deregulation and ease of setting up a company within your society. So, and this is what it looks like in the world. So currently the number one in the world for freedom, economic freedom is Hong Kong. But as you can see, again, it's what you would expect. Developed nations tend to have high levels of economic freedom. France, of course, with its love of bureaucracy, is a little bit lower. But and again, many of the former communist countries still seem to have this problem. They still seem to be shaking off the shackles of communism there. And then finally, the rule of law index. I don't need to go into that into detail, but as you can see, the lighter that it is, the better the rule of law. The darker that it is, the worse the rule of law. And again, I think that's fairly self-explanatory. There's a number of countries in Africa which they just simply don't have the data for there. But as you can see, so it's, again, it's the countries that we'd expect have good rule of law or have good rule of law. Right, so I think that covers everything. Any questions? We all sorted? Good, good. Right, I'll pass things over to Andre. I'll just... Wasn't that friend? It's deaf.
The word of humanity.
Yeah. But yeah, it's if you discount natural causes, it's the number one killer in human history. Not war. Which everybody finds very surprising, you know. Because you would assume, I mean, people love killing each other in war, but it turns out governments love killing civilians even more.
I'm not surprised by that.
Yeah. Have you ever heard of a chap called Noam Chomsky? So I'm not a great fan of this, but he says, you know, governments are inherently a violent thing by nature. And it's up to the population to effectively control your government. Lest bad things happen. It's not too wrong. Oh, I'll take this. I'm disappointed so few people to go back today. Mm.
Whether Trump should have won or not, because Hillary lost in the states where they were done electronically, so she won by paper.
Oh, okay. To be honest, I think a lot of people are just grasping at straws.
It's the same as the Brexit thing.
Yeah, it's a lot of people are very salty that they didn't get what they wanted, but they also think that not only is Trump wrong, they think that he is inherently evil, and therefore it must, you know, it's the moral right to stop him. It's an undermines democracy and undermines, you know, a bunch of what I've talked about here, this idea of rule of law. If they can overthrow what was, you know, a democratically decided legal decision, then it completely undermines it. I mean, could you imagine what would happen if somebody managed to, like, find a way to keep Trump from being president? It would be
chaotic, but so funny. It would be amazing.
It would be hilarious.
The joke of Trump, that would pretty much be amazing.
Mm. It would end in bloodshed.
There's a thing that they're trying to do now because they want to try and stop Brexit, and so everyone's
getting
angry.
It's going to happen. It's going to happen. There's nothing we can say. Otherwise, if we had, if we could change our minds at every turn, we'd never get anything done.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't want to believe, but...
No, yeah, but...
We can do it. That's it.
I said, in a, the decision was made, that's, you know, democracy, sometimes you don't get what you want.
Mm. I learned the hard way this year. But Joe Trump did say, like, he played the game really well, though.
Mm.
Really well. He did a terrible job. Like,
I, if it was, if she had run like 10 years ago, she would be the perfect candidate.
Mm.
But she no longer makes sense in the modern world.
Yeah.
And she was the worst possible person they could put against Trump. If it was Bernie Sanders, he would have rinsed.
He would be amazing, but.
Well. Because.
Why can't we have Obama back? Yeah. If we're on our third year, why don't we just do that?
Correct. Your sources?
Yeah, we can start.
Wonderful.
No, conflict in the eastern of Ukraine. I don't know, I think you something you hear in the news, maybe in the TV program which happens in Ukraine today, and what way goes our side, Ukrainian government, and the Russia side in this conflict in the eastern of Ukraine. But start from the beginning, from the start or beginning of this conflict. And Wikipedia says that all started on 20th February 2014 from the Russian intervention army forced in the territory of Crimea. But for me, I can say that I think that all start very, very early in maybe in the 1991, from the day when Ukraine started was independent, because from that time Russia spy, Russia Federation became informational war about against from Ukraine, against from Ukrainian language, Ukrainian culture, and another Ukrainian things which must help us to be a true, truly independent country. And I think, and a lot of people think, that it started early, early in the 1991. But from the Wikipedia, in the forced or military occupied of Ukraine start from the 20th of February, and I have some videos from a few moments or a few informational moments for you, which say from what and who starts this.
It's been a year since Russia annexed Crimea from Ukraine. Although there are still a lot of questions about the Russian government's actions, the big picture is much clearer now that the dust has settled. Let's take a look at the timeline of events surrounding Crimea's deceptive annexation. Violent anti-government protests sparked the Ukrainian revolution and the ousting of President Viktor Yanukovych. Russian President Vladimir Putin holds a secret meeting about extracting the deposed Yanukovych and annexing Crimea from Ukraine. Heavily armed pro-Russian gunmen occupy the Crimean parliament and allegedly force the emergency instatement of a new pro-Russian prime minister. The new Crimean prime minister takes control of Ukraine's security forces and officially asks Russia to provide assistance in assuring peace. Russia pledges the use of their armed forces in Ukraine. President Putin tells reporters that the unidentified soldiers occupying Crimean military bases are not Russian, and says that Russia will not try to annex Crimea. A planned referendum to accede Crimea to Russia is condemned by the Ukrainian government, the US, and the EU. Russia announces massive military exercises along the Ukrainian border. The US Department of State calls this an intimidation attempt in the lead-up to the referendum. Officials report that 95.5% of Crimean voters support joining Russia in the referendum, but many residents abstain. No international observation of the vote is allowed. The Crimean Parliament officially joins the Russian Federation. US President Barack Obama announces sanctions against Russian and Ukrainian officials. The G8 votes to oust Russia over the unconstitutional referendum. They become the G7. Additionally, 100 countries support a UN resolution calling the March 16th referendum illegal. Russia accidentally releases documents suggesting the referendum vote may have been falsified. President Vladimir Putin admits that despite originally denying any involvement, the invasion and annexation of Crimea was planned all along. In the years since, a number of hard-hitting sanctions have been imposed on Russia by the United States and their international allies, crippling the Russian economy. In spite of widespread condemnation, Putin has made no concessions regarding Crimea and may have his eye on the rest of Ukraine. To learn more about the conflict between Russia and
Okay, as you understand, it's so small old video from 1 year, from 2015, but it shows how it happens, how it will be continue from the 2014 years, from the February till the December or to the 2015 years. As said in the video, all started in legal in the first March of 2014, when the State Duma of Russian Federation introduction the Russian troops on the drugs in the territory of Ukraine and especially in Crimea. It's started very, very early, as I said, from the 20 February, and it started from the takes of government buildings, some plants, fabrics, or army or military department, and in whole territory of Crimea started to became Russian vehicles without Russia flag and Russian soldiers without any emblems and without any symbols of Russia. They told that the only people who want to be who want to live better. That's all, but we understand that the people who want to live better can have all the uniform, the simple uniform like in Russia soldiers, and they haven't the special automatic guns. It's not true, and it's very laughable for us to hear this information from Russian Federation. There are no soldiers in Crimea, but with connection with very bad and demoralization Ukraine army, Crimea was was annexed from no one shooting from Ukraine and or Russia army. It takes from no one shooting, no people was killed or died from when started this annexed. It's now and some people say that it's a very big problem for us why we don't defend from this from this takeoffs of Crimea, but another expert says that if in the coast of Crimea we haven't the Russian Navy, which stays there from the 1991, it was not be so quick and so fast. It not be possible to do this with to do annexed Crimea so fast as they do this. That's why there are a lot of things about them who must be punished. I don't know, but which happened we see, and it's not enough. After Crimea, Russian government thinking that the Ukrainian army is demoralized and destroyed, and they think that they can take off or eastern Ukraine or eastern and south Ukraine. And from the April and it from the April it, in a few whole was the east of Lugansk and Donetsk regions, but from the 20 February, maybe in March, start take off government building in all eastern regions, especially in Donetsk, Luhansk, Zaporizhia, and Kharkiv regions, but successful was only in the two regions, not enough regions, it's only in the regions of Luhansk and in the part of regions of Donetsk. In the map you can see the first, it's August of 2014, you can see the how Russian Federation start to take off all of this east part of Ukraine, where is the brown color you can see, it's the DPR, it's the Donetsk People Republic, it's a name for Russian Federation structure, and LPR, the blue you can see, it's the Luhansk People Republic. The same the structure of Russian interventions, and you can see the fire pictures that were the most big battles from this territory, and Ukrainian government start to defend Ukraine, start to defend the territory, and maybe. This late but good commander in the material sides of Ukraine will be successful for European and for our country. Don't to stop Russian intervention to the Ukraine territory because we have as. We have the information that in advance, Russian wants to take all the SSR east side and south side of Ukraine, including the Odessa regions, Khmelnytsk, and Kharkiv, Zaporizhia, Dnipropetrovsk regions. For your understanding now, I like to show you the actual maps of this anti-terroristic operation, but for this all the Ukrainian maps, I can see that I can say that only for this territory goes Russian soldiers, and this territory is now is anti-terroristic operation. Like which name is our government and people, all people in Ukraine name it the war in Russia. No anything like in the war with Russia. That's why they start to a very big battle, very horror battle for Ukrainian side, and one of there is one of this is a Ilovaisk cattle which happened in August 2014 when the Ukrainian wants to attack the tourist sites now government says it's like a tourist site. Tourist sites, our forest will be surrounding the DNP soldiers, and we have our soldiers have only one way to exit. You can see this way, but there are a lot of soldiers of DNP, and this exit is shutting down from the all sides. And while and during this exit killed more than 500 Ukrainian soldiers, and hundreds of them were involved and captured. And no, for today, no one takes the punish for this operation. No generals will be punished for commanding, for bad commanding. After that happened the Debaltseve, the strategies in the Debaltseve. It's the same way, it's the same situation, that Ukrainian wants to attack the terroristic force, soldiers, and but have go to the have go to surrounding territory, and near 200 people, so Ukrainian soldiers died, and hundreds of them go to occupied, to captured and wounded. I don't know how it who must be punished, and what is the reason of this strategy, but now I think the Ukrainian army was much more better, and now we haven't this problem. But it's a pity that all rules for us, for people, must write a blood. Yes, it's a very, very big, very bad. And for civil civil losses of our in our country, it will be in December 2014, where you can see the map. It's an anti-terroristic operation. Yes, it's a white color, and yellow color is the peace territory, is Ukrainian territory, but from the territory of Russia, the rockets named Grad, you know, Grad, shut down the territory of Volnovakha, and we have the near 11 civilians died, injured near 64 people, and in this amount will be was 5 children. And now I have a video, but if you don't want see a very horrible, you can go out from 1 or 5 minutes. First of all, I show you how it happens in real time. Yeah, you see. It's a road. Oh, you can see, yeah. How the multi rocket Grad. It's a Grad. Yeah, you can see how it happens. But it's not enough. It's very good to see it in the white snow, yeah? How it happened in December. And you can see it's the car is a taxi in what where was the people, and the one of the shouting trapped to this car, and now I see how it commenting in the Reuters.
11 killed as bus hit by heavy fire in eastern Ukraine. Ukraine officials and Russian-backed separatists have been trading accusations following the Tuesday attack on a passenger bus in eastern Ukraine that left 11 people dead. Tensions between the two sides have escalated in recent days, threatening to derail the truce that has been in place since December. 11 people died in eastern Ukraine on Tuesday afternoon when a bus carrying civilians was attacked as it passed through the government checkpoint in the eastern town of Volnovakha. Kiev said rebels had attacked the bus using Grad rocket launchers. While separatists said they did not have the capability to launch such attacks because of the distance, they accused Kiev of being behind the attack, saying it had been hit by small arms fire. In the early hours of Tuesday, separatists launched attacks on Donetsk's Sergei Prokofiev Airport using Grad missile launchers. The air traffic control tower, which has been battered by gunfire for months, collapsed. The bus attack resulted in the biggest loss of life in Ukraine so far this year. It is estimated that more than 4,700 people have been killed since the conflict began last April.
Tromanu.net is throwing $100 bills at the 20 funniest comments on our website every month. Oh, yes, Tromanu.
You can see that Russian side says that it can be possible for the distance where is the Volnovakha situated. Yes, in the Ukrainian territory, they said that is. Our army shattered the own territory to show that Ukraine, that Russian side is don't do the order which have from European Union, but our military have the truth that it's in fact that it's one multi-copter rocket grad go to this side, yes, and do the shut this territory from the, as you see, from the territory of LPN, and go away and go to the Russian territory. Like we don't do nothing in this territory. It's for today. It's the biggest losses in the conflict of eastern Ukraine for our country and for all period of this conflict. And from the start. Like right to Wikipedia and to the today, we have killed more than 15,000 Ukrainian soldiers and civilian people. Near 115,000 were wounded and more than 1,000 captured. Now you can see the actually. Map of the anti-terrorist operation of war in the east of Ukraine, and you can see the border of all sides. Yeah, it's a border of all sides. It's one of the tags of Minsk that said that all vehicle which have calibers much more 15 millimeters can go from this side, and it's like a regime no fire regime which must be must be protect all sides from the shadow, but It's not happened. The Russian side it's don't do this now, and you can see the actually a map from the Azov Sea to the Luhansk. You can see part of Luhansk, and from the all this border of Ukraine. Every day goes the high class military hikers of Russian soldiers, and with soldiers and the Russian army. And back to the Minsk, some people from the from southeast conflict said that Ukraine must. Defense must attack and must go out this military or terroristic units from our country from the border. But if real sees in this conflict, we understand that the one way and the one possible way to back our territories and. To have some, to have peace in this territory is, as you can say, is agreement. Yes, is some a decision in a bureaucratical maybe ways, which made it possible to make peace in this territory. And in 11th, 12th of February. 2015 in Minsk decide that decide some tasks which must be do for have peace in this territory. First of all, it's immediately and complete stop FR in parts of Donetsk and Luhansk regions. Till today, it's not done. Every day we have near 200 shots in. The sites of terrorists, but our soldiers not answer. But in the situation where we where there is so the terrorist units go to the our sites. Yes, they must to protect. They must to shot and. They protect not only territory, they protect their own life. But one or two times a day we have a tank shots and grenade shots in the territory of Ukraine. And I don't know why, but the OSCE think visits or supervisions don't see that, and they don't can inform European Union that it was happened, and we have with this we have a big problem to prove actually shutting is very hard that because supervision of OSCE. Don't write this in the report. The next one, the extraction of heavy weapons by both sides at a distance at least 15 kilometers. As I said in the previous, it was done. But twice a day we have this shooting. As I understand, all supervision of OSCE said that all vehicles go to the 15 kilometers, but as I understand, they go back for 1-2 hours, make some shootings from the territory and go back. And next one to ensure the release, the release and exchange of all hostage and illegally detained persons. From the February it was